Hi, guys and gals. Glad y'all are here. Let me introduce myself. My name is Jeff Edwards. I've been in Round Rock now for 22 years. Back when there was only 27 people here in town, 27,000 people here in town. So, give you a quick background. I've been in this industry for a long time. Was 20 years with Hewlett Packard, two years with Agilent, 10 years with Tektronix, now 2.5 years with TestEquity. So the entire time, I've always been in test and measurement. So straight out of college, I was in test and measurement. So that's my quick background. And family of four, you saw my oldest son. Any questions about me? I am local, so if you have any questions about any things that you've seen here, feel free to call me. I have a stack of business cards here. I'm more than happy to pass them out. So let me tell you a little bit about TestEquity. We are the largest technical distributor in the country. I'm responsible for the test and measurement products, which is TestEquity is broken up into two parts. So that's everything that you can see on this side. Everything from oscilloscopes, power supplies, vector network analyzers, DBMs, things like that. We also manufacture, you'll see down here all the brands that we carry. Right here in the middle, you'll see TestEquity. The reason why TestEquity is on here is because we actually design, manufacture, and stock our own environmental chambers. So if you need a tip cycle, a cell phone, Bluetooth, any kind of device that's going to be used in a variety of different environments, we actually do environmental chambers. We're doing real hot, real cold. We also do humidity as well. And all the high-tech companies, you'll see our chambers and all of that. The other part of our business is we do MRO supplies. So these are products that we go with an R&D lab, anywhere from microscopes, magnifiers, benches, chairs, workstations, you name it. Tools, we'll talk about that some more in a little bit. We also sell refurbished equipment for some of you, those that might be looking for that. We also rent and lease test equipment as well as sell used and new. As a quick overview of who TestEquity is, a quick list of all the different product types that we carry, including the environmental chambers that we do. Thermal imaging, I actually brought a thermal imager up here. I'll try to see if I can get a broadcast over the camera so you can take a look at that. And these are the different types of supplies that our tool and supply people. So there's two TestEquity employees in town. I'm the one that does test equipment. There's another one here in town that does all this type of stuff. And he has been doing this for over 30 years as well. So if you want to know the difference between a hot coat, mint cow, paste, weller, or soldering iron, he's the guy to talk to. That's not me. The biggest thing that happened was that this year we acquired Jensen Tools. So they're really known for doing, you've probably seen these suitcases, they've been around since I was in high school. These suitcases right here, you open up, it's got all the tools in the appropriate spot. We bought Jensen Tools from Black & Decker and Stanley here back in January. So now that makes us the largest MRO supplier in the country. And you can see how some of the other products that they carry here as well. And that's our headquarters building in Moore Park, California. We're now outside of Los Angeles. So that's who TestEquity is. Any questions? All right. So we haven't practiced this. However, we have discussed it. There's going to be two of us. And we're going to be time tagging between different PCs and different types of test equipment. So just hang in there with us as we kind of try to get everything running. Patterson, your turn, sir.
All right. Thanks, Jeff. Okay, so I got a couple of slides. I got a super few slides, maybe you can do I'm going to try to roll through it quick. I'm more than happy to follow what you're doing time to be on. But we got a bunch of things here with buttons and knobs on them and things like that. And they're really specifically aimed at some. I'm here local as well, and at the end, if you have to put some fingers on these buttons, that's okay too. Okay, you have any questions, let me know. A little bit about the agenda. We'll talk a little bit mainly about kind of the test challenges that you try to see. Who here is actually designing something for IoT right now? Who's just kind of our hobbyist? Excellent. So I think the people that are designing should walk away with something, the hobbyists should walk away with something as well.
I asked a question, it's actually quite a good hardware engineers.
So let's just talk a little bit about something you guys probably already know, like what's driving the IoT market. And you know, if you kind of look at kind of what's happened over time, you kind of had what they call the Internet of People, and that's where instead of connected devices on the internet being like a PC or something like that, it started turning into people walking around with phones in their hand. Just people needed an IP address. And really what's shifted over time, it's really kind of stacking up, there's only so many people, is what they call the Internet of Things. And so, you know, one person could have, you know, several dozen, you know, IPs assigned to their body instead of just having, you know, kind of one per person. And that's why IPv6 is kind of prevailing right now, because you're just running out of addresses. So this is kind of where we're at right now. And it's driving, you know, meetups like this and, you know, technology like we're seeing right now on the table. Where are you seeing that? I'm kind of an old country farm guy from South Texas. And even back in back in the olden days, farmers really relied on data on their crops. Worked for a crop duster that, you know, he would fly a field and they would, you know, take particularly data on the dusting, and they would send that up. That was a long time ago. That was in the 80s. Right? I'm an old guy. And so, you know, but now it's a lot more sophisticated. Certainly in the home, that's kind of where it's really taken off. This is more consumer based. And you have health, which is a little bit more constrained with compliance and regulation. And then automotive, which is, you know, going to probably be next ramp, where you're going to see a lot of interaction with the internet, whether it's vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to machine, vehicle to grid. There's going to be a lot of IoT activity coming in here. So, what's happening? You know, anytime you have a bunch of volume, it gets ginned. Typically, what happens is you get more competition and you get some economies of scale. And this thing is a little bit old, it's 2016, but if you just look at the price of everything, everything has fallen in the last few years, it's pretty dramatic. And even me as a hobbyist, I mean, I remember, you know, buying an Arduino and going, this is amazing, I can't believe I got all this horsepower for $35 or $45. And, you know, if somebody asked me to do that now, I'd go like $35 or $40. You know, it's got some I/O and some PWM, but you know, I don't know, you got a jack on Bluetooth into it. And now, just bought an ESP8266. I think it's at $5, right? It's got onboard Wi-Fi. So all these prices are getting crashed down. So what happens is, you know, for the person who's designing it or working with it, it puts tremendous cost pressure on you as a company. It's like, how I can't afford to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on a test rig to test my design and get it to market when my margins are going to be kind of following this type of price trend. Now, that's probably, you know, all stuff that you guys know, as well as this. You know, I just mentioned I had this Arduino. It was basically an Atmel microcontroller. Now that same capability and more is modularized, and it's on a, you know, it's on a board. It's cheaper because all of these different modules are getting pushed into, you know, kind of one solution. And there's certain areas where things are just booming, like sensors. You know, used to just detecting light was kind of a cool thing. Now you have sensors that can detect wavelengths of light, pressure, gases, RF presence. It's think about the Pixel sensors, where they actually can, you know, do face recognition just based on imaging from laser. It's pretty impressive. And that's getting all pushed into one IoT type solution. Okay, so that probably didn't surprise anybody here. Surprised IoT is getting cheaper, smaller, faster. So you're in the right place. So let's kind of come talk about test challenge number one on the list. And really, if you kind of think about, you know, the food chain for IoT, it really varies. You have people that are, have chipsets or really radios. You have people doing end products. And depending on where you are in this food chain or how you interact with this food chain, you'll have different challenges along the way. But there's one challenge that's going to be pretty consistent throughout this. And that is, you're going to have to make some decisions on how this thing is going to behave. You're going to have to ask yourself, how am I going to connect this thing wirelessly? As well as IoT devices, the I stands for internet. You got to get this thing on the network. So how are you going to do that? What standards are you going to use? When you finally start pushing this product forward, is there going to be a point in time where you're going to need to meet some regulations? We talked about the power supply regulations. What time you're going to have to consider that? Are you going to try to piece together a bunch of modules, or are you going to buy some type of SoC that just kind of integrates this all into one? How are you going to, what type of software considerations are you going to go through? These are all the types of things that regardless of where you are in the food chain, you're probably asking yourself a lot of these questions along the way. And I apologize for walking over this PC at the slide. So, if you think about an IoT device, you're kind of in the wireless world. You kind of have a transmitter and you have a receiver. And if you're involved with the receiver portion, there's certain things that you need to be concerned with in developing that receiver. And that is how tolerant it is to the faults, how far can it pick something up, how well can it listen over kind of the noise. Show that kind of firsthand in a second. Those are all pretty tough challenges, and you really can't do those just in the open air. You have to have some type of way to inject the known signal into your receiver so you can find out if it can tolerate the noise or interference. And so there will be an underlying commercial through this whole presentation, but I'm in business development and not sales, so certainly you'll see a lot of Tektronix emblems on here. If you have a problem with IoT, I'd ask that you buy it from Tektronix and you get it from Jeff. But other than that, that's kind of my sales pitch. Because really, I'm really here to kind of make you aware of the problems and that there are some answers. But as far as where you get the solutions, you should only be from Tektronix and Tesla. So one of the things that that you may have to do is a receiver sensitivity test. And to do that, what you would do is you would use a signal generator, and I'm not talking about like an AFG or a function generator that you're typically used to using. Tektronix makes a vector signal generator. Generate quantum signals, and also AM/FM modulation. They can simulate constellations. You can change beta era or error vector magnitude error to find out how tolerant your receiver is. So this is one type of way to find out if your receiver is compliant. And you can also gain two of these together and put them into a mixer and also find out if your receiver can tolerate interference. So you can maybe pump in a high amplitude FM signal here, put your QAM in here, find out, hey, how does that affect my radio? The tough thing with IoT, particularly when you're going through design, it kind of, you know, when I pick up my phone and I ask it to connect to a Bluetooth speaker, I kind of expect that to work. When I want to jump onto a Wi-Fi network, I kind of expect that to work. But as a designer, I know that there's a ton of effort and work that goes into that. Because you have all these, particularly the, like the 2.4 gig band, you have all these technologies competing in space on different protocols. They all have different power considerations. And basically, you're in a war zone. So how do you deal with this? Like, how do you deal with the fact that you have, you know, if there was some way to color the RF signals in this room, it would look very vivid, but we can't see it. But if you're designing a product, that all of a sudden becomes very important to you. And so the way we do that at Tektronix in a cheap way, or I should say low-cost way, is we use a real-time spectrum analyzer. Okay? We used to call it an RSA-306. It's this little handheld device right here. And it does a ton of stuff. Compliance testing, we'll be talking about this. But right now, we're just going to show you kind of what's in this room from the Wi-Fi point of view. Okay? It's all its power through USB 3. It sends all the data to the PC through USB 3. It's a phenomenal box. It's got a point of intercept of 100 microseconds. That means if a signal has a transient greater than 100 microseconds, we guarantee you'll catch it. So if you're doing frequency hopping for some reason, it's a great tool. But let's just take a look at what this guy shows us is in this room. Okay? So has anybody here not seen a spectrum analyzer before? Or doesn't know what a spectrum analyzer does? Okay. That's fine. So, you know, typically people are used to seeing oscilloscopes, right? And oscilloscope is kind of like, you know, if you take like a heartbeat, because you're perfect, you're kind of seeing a movie where there's a heartbeat on the screen. And it's really, that heartbeat is really plotting voltage level over time. That's really what you're seeing. The heart rate is putting out voltage dividing over time. A spectrum analyzer does something similar but different. Instead of this being the time axis of the oscilloscope, this is frequency, okay? On the x-axis. And on the y-axis is RF power. Okay? So what are we looking at right now? We are tuned in to 2.44 gigahertz. That's our center frequency. So right here, that's 2.44 gigahertz. That's kind of right in the middle of Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, so I didn't choose this by accident. We're spanning 48 megahertz, meaning there's 20 megahertz on this side, there's 20 megahertz on this side. And so we're seeing RF amplitude on the y-axis. So we know that we're kind of tuned into the Wi-Fi area, right? We're seeing this here, which is RF power. We're seeing this here, which is RF power. So anybody have a guess on what those two, we call these bark signals, you know, some people call these bark signals, we look at bark said. Do you get a guess on what those are? Not so. Exactly. Yeah. So these are Wi-Fi channels, right? So you know when you got a network router, you know you have a bunch of you know channels. So we're looking at two channels, and every now and then we'll see this thing get hit with some power. See, we just saw some power jump up here. So you can see this in the top screen here. The signals that are bright red are really high in amplitude. Okay. And we see this graph here going up.
So I'm sorry, did you say that like each of those would be like channel 5 and channel 6 on like a Wi-Fi
router?
Yeah, so
I think this is 10 and 11, but yeah, you're right.
Okay.
It's two different channels. Or no, this would be probably 9 and 11, I think. So yeah, those are two different channels, the 2.4 gigabit area. We also have a kind of a running record of what happened in this just amazing. I just saw a little spike right here. You see your line that says you spike here. I can throw a bunch of markers up here and find out how long these take place, what your amplitude is. I'm going to do something right now with my phone. I'm going to turn off my Bluetooth, okay? And my phone is going to try to break connection with my watch. So anytime you see like a picket fence looking thing, you immediately know that's Bluetooth, right? We could decode that if we want. If we want it, we could demodulate that and turn that into hex or ones and zeros. I could, in a quieter room under the right situations, I could turn this into ones and zeros. I could sit in Starbucks and watch traffic go over. It's all encrypted, so it doesn't be good, but you can do it. So I'm gonna turn off my, I'm gonna turn off my Bluetooth signal on my phone. And right there, my phone, my watch right now, you see these signals? Mm-hmm. You see over here? My watch is trying to look for my phone right now. So if I go back, it's connecting right now. So it's syncing, it's connecting, and it's chattering that you see is it's syncing back up to my watch. Okay. So the only reason I point that out is because if you're doing IoT design, it is a war zone. I mean, we're just sitting here right here, and just the stuff that's operating right now is crazy. And you have to design these things, considering these things. We have a microwave oven, you'd be seeing that in here too.
How far of a radius is that reading?
Well, so that's just a, you know, a Amazon rubber ducky antenna. So it's really, it really depends on your antenna.
Fine, would you say that what we're seeing there is just in this room?
So let me tell you what I'm looking at. So see these two signals here? You can see one bar signal's kind of higher, and one bar signal's kind of lower here.
Uh-huh.
And it's lower than this signal here. This looks to me like this is a tower. It's pretty close, right? And it's continually screaming, you know, I'm looking for somebody. And every now and then, you see a smaller signal. This over here, my guess is, this is a router that somebody on a PC or something like that is watching Netflix or something like that. Because on this screen, I can see one signal here, and I can see another signal that's just riding a little bit below it, right? You can kind of see two signals that kind of look the same, that keep on flashing in and out. Really what you're looking at is you're looking at the traffic between a PC and a router. I don't know which one's closer, but these guys are probably, it's like this thing, like in a machine shop or something like that. But I can see that there's some communication going on between two internet connected devices. Whereas this guy here, it looks like he's pretty quiet. Every now and then something pings it. But that's blue, right? That right there is blue too. Somebody right there is doing something blue that is probably kind of insurance.
The Bluetooth shut off.
Alright, so that is that's my war zone pitch. And so this is an RSA-306, amazing piece of kit. You can get it from Test Equity.
How much?
Around $3,500.
$3,500.
That's up to Jeff to do that. But I'm just.
I will tell you, this package he's talking about is called SignalView. It's a package that also runs on. It ran initially on all the RSA-5000 series spectrum analyzers that have been around for many, many years. This is high-end spectrum analyzers that Tektronix made. They ported it over to run on Windows. So now it also runs on other platforms to control these smaller RSA spectrum analyzers and their high-end 30 gigahertz, 80 gigahertz scopes. This application will run on there. So this isn't some simple app that somebody wrote. This is a $10 million investment in software that Tektronix has in SignalView. And you get it for free when you buy an RSA
system. It is amazing. This is one of those things that people, it's really not sold as well. Because people are typically, you know, I typically ask somebody, hey, what would you expect to pay for this? And the answer is probably, you know, 80-ish grand, 60 grand or something. But, you know, just like IoT is cheaper, smaller, faster, these things are getting the same way, and Tektronix is able to leverage off of a lot of software tiers for something.
Any questions on this? So what is this? What is the benefit of reading?
Yeah, okay. So, I mean, there's a couple of things that you might want to do. Let's say you're chasing interference, right? You're looking for interference. example, where, you know, you pan this somewhere, like, you know, you say you have a project, right? Let's just say it's a little while, and it's internet connected, and every now and then it just goes off in the weeds. It could be because you can't handle a bunch of interference, not that long. You don't know that. I share something with this, and you can see, you know, like, these power bursts going across. This power burst might be caused by you. It may be caused by you spinning up the motor, caused by somebody else. The other thing is, you know, people that just want to, like, demodulate on or demodulate Bluetooth. You know, if you have a Bluetooth sensor that gives you temperature pressure, and you have a microcontroller, and you're trying to you're getting good temperature readings, you're not getting good sensor readings, but you know from the data sheet when you send this microcontroller a sequence EF, EF, FF, I should get a reading, right? You could demodulate that with this guy and say, well, the reason I'm not getting that sensor reading is I'm not sending that data across. I'm sending that data across and it's not making it because my receiver's not tolerant enough or who knows why. But without seeing it, being able to demodulate it, you're kind of shooting it.
So the software, does it have tools to do the demodulation and stuff for you?
It does. So the single view software, PC software you see is free. There's like, we'll talk about some of these, but there's like probably a couple dozen packages that get you into different compliance testing, Bluetooth, a bunch of different types of QAM, a bunch of different LAN, RF power, FCC specifications, different things like that.
FCC rules, the airwaves, we as engineers have to go out and design the IoT products to be able to talk to each other. They can't interfere with each other, they can't interfere with somebody that's wearing, you know, some sort of device, a pacemaker, one cell phone can interfere with another one. This enables us to see that. That's where it's special. You're a mechanical engineer, it's kind of like an engine analyzer. You've got to see where the spark's going, you've got to make sure it all works together. If it doesn't work, this enables you to see that. But you can't see with our eyes.
Okay, so I'm gonna let Jeff do the next demo, and hurry up, and these guys are gonna be very excited.
So, who's gonna be upset?
These guys, because we've got a lot to show them.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And on top of that, I've been told this projector, after 1 hour, goes out for 2 minutes. So if it goes out for 2 minutes, go do your body break and come back, because suppose it picks on, we just keep going. So, what I'm going to talk about is the ability to look at several different domains. And you see we've got digital, we've got analog, and we've got RF all on there. So your typical device, embedded device, you'll see different aspects of it. Here you've got your antenna, you've got your RF section, you may have antenna mismatches. Over here you've got your microcontroller for your different interfaces. So this is kind of your digital domain. And this is your frequency domain. Then you might want to take a look at power, so that's analog domain. So, is anybody familiar with those terms, frequency domain or time domain? Right. So, frequency domain is what we were seeing at. That's what the spectrum analyzer was you were just looking at. Okay. Time domain is what an oscilloscope is. Amplitude versus time. Frequency is amplitude versus spectrum analyzer is amplitude versus frequency. And then you've got the digital domain. It's looking at things digital. So I'm gonna move on here. So here's one where you might have multiple signals across multiple different domains. I had a customer that back when I used to call him NASA Johnson Space Center back in the 80s, he wanted to take a spectrum analyzer and a scope, and it was not fathomable back in the day, but he worked very hard to sync up two different chassis and have one cross-trigger the other, okay? But then once you got the information and you figured out the prop delay and how long it took for it to trigger, and you know they say it's a nanosecond per foot, it's more like, I think that's light. Coax is like 8 inches per foot, right? So, 8 inches per nanosecond, sorry, I said that wrong. Anyway, how do you sync the cables up? And how do you sync up these two mainframes? And once you have your displays, how do you put them on the screen at the same time? This is back in the 80s, he was trying to do this, right? That's where this product that I'm fixing to show you kind of comes in. So this is a product, in fact, let me go ahead and just hook it up now. So you can kind of see the display. Fortunately, in this particular case, this piece of equipment has a video output jack. So this is called a multiple domain oscilloscope, which means you can see things in the frequency, time, and digital domain. It also does things in the modulation domain, but we won't go into that too much. So this right now, this is default setup. We power it up, this is how it comes up. I can also push one button. And now the entire screen is a spectrum analyzer. And you can kind of see one waveform right over here that's up on the screen. I can turn it off. Now here's my oscilloscope.
That spectrum analyzer, is that just a FFT of the oscilloscope window?
It's different. The fifth input of this product has a separate RF path. They stripped one of the guys off the RF team that did the spectrum analyzers, and he developed circuitry, so there's a different RF path. Most oscilloscopes do have some sort of FFT, very rudimentary, doesn't do a very good job at it. The problem with doing that, first off, you can't do a start-stop adjustment of frequencies, a resolution bandwidth. It's very, very difficult on the ones that do a poor implementation of FFT, right? With this product, not only do you have all the controls of a spectrum analyzer, but it also goes to the fifth input path, which means that now I'm not limited to the bandwidth of the scope. So if the scope is 1 gigahertz, on a traditional scope, you're gonna have 1 gigahertz bandwidth. Well, if you do the FFT, you add 1 gigahertz bandwidth on the FFT, right? With the fifth input, this is a 1 gigahertz scope, 4 1 gigahertz channels. The fifth input is a 6 gigahertz spectrum analyzer. So you're not limited by the path of the A to D of the scope you're using. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. Basically, the answer was no.
Yes. How's that for you? One of my favorite demos that I really like with this guy, because it shows multiple things all at once. To show you is what that customer of mine back at work at Lockheed back in the day, what he was trying to do, and this product is able to enable you to do that. So what we got here is we're looking at a VCO enabled line, and when the VCO enabled line goes up, there is actually a spy bus. Now this spy bus is comprised of three channels. In this particular case, you can do spy bus on the analog channels of the scope, but you can also do it with the logic analyzer channels as well, and that's what we're doing in this case over three digital channels. That's what this little burst is. So this is four instruments in one. I mentioned three of them. I mentioned the scope, spectrum analyzer, logic analyzer. The fourth one is a protocol analyzer. Okay? So, and that's how we're able to pull this up right here. So I'm going to, you see this little bar right here? This is called spectrum time. This is the point in time, looking at all these signals, and this is the time domain, this is the frequency domain. This is what we're looking at that correlates to what's up on the screen right here. So I'm going to take this bar and move it to the right. You see this little RF signal pop up right here? Let's take a look at what's in this little bus here. So I'm going to do this little zoom feature. So you see everything around these brackets right here, one bracket there. That's everything across the screen that you're seeing. I'm going to continue to zoom in. Here's a trigger point right here. And what do you see here at the trigger point? You see 20, 31, 41. See that trigger? That's what we triggered off of. If we take a look at our trigger menu, that's exactly what we told you. You cannot see it. It's off the screen. But you'll see 20, 31, 41 right across the screen right here. It's the very, very bottom. I don't know if you can see that. But that's what we're triggering off of. That's the power of this guy, the ability to see all those domains simultaneously at the same time. Now, this is about the time I get people going, wow. This is really cool. For decades, people have been trying to do this. So, as we come across, I'm going to adjust where in time we're looking. So we're going to move these two brackets right over here. We're going to scroll down. Let me turn them on. So what happens in this case, VCO enable goes high. This bus sends a spy bus command to the VCO and tells the VCO to change to this new frequency. So what you're going to get now is the PLL voltage, phase lock loop voltage, is going to ripple down to the new lower. So this is channel one, this is channel two right here. So this is still the two scope channels. This is the logic analyzer sitting right here. And we're going to sit here and you're going to see this thing ripples down. So it takes a while for it to sync up, right? While it's taking some time to sync up, I'm going to slowly but surely move it over. Watch as this frequency starts shifting. See how it's moving over? Because this kind of goes up and goes down, it shifts back and forth. And it over swings right here. And it takes off for it to settle back down. Now you'll see the signal go back and settle to the middle. Everybody see that? This is all time correlated. That's the power of this guy, frequency. Time domain, frequency domain, and digital domain, all time aligned screen at the same time. That's the power of this guy. So, let's see here. Any questions on this so far? Well, that's your logic. I will show you one other thing. Let me turn off the, a lot of people want to see what that bus looks like. So I'm going to come over here. Here's those three channels on that bus we were looking at. There's the channels right there. Those are the digital channels. That's where we were getting these bus commands from, those three spy bus lines. Any questions? Okay, moving on.
Can you do I2C as well?
Pardon?
I2C as well.
Yeah, I2C, SPI, CAN, LIN, RS-232, all the different buses, you can do that there. Okay, so, test challenge number three, maximizing your device's battery life. So here's a real simplified block diagram with a lot of wireless devices that are very small and portable. One of my favorites that I actually personally own is this guy right here. This has got 6 hours of battery life. It's my Bluetooth headset that I just plug into my ear. But this is the cradle that it fits in. So it's got 3 hours of itself. If I drain this guy, I just take it in, plug it in, I plug it in my pocket. Why has this thing been good to me? Because for the last 2 years, I've never had any problem with running out of juice on this guy. That's why it's important to design battery life into your product. So in this particular case, you can kind of see here's your antenna, your RF, analog digital, similar to the other block diagram of the battery. When it's pulsed, and when you transmit, everything that's wireless these days is bursty in nature. And because it's bursty in nature, it is, if you can think of pulling a juice from your battery in a pulse nature, that's exactly what it's doing. So you have to design a device that can be in deep sleep, which can be as low as nanoamps, in a sleep mode, which can be microamps to milliamps, or in a standby mode, which can be microamps to milliamps, but in a transmit mode, it can be as high as milliamps to amps. So you have to design a product that can handle all these three areas and know what that looks like. Here's a good example of when a product powers up. the different pulsed modes it looks like as it's consuming power from the battery. I'm going to switch over to this camera. I've got a camera hooked up to a what they call a battery simulator. This 2281 is a battery simulator.
So while Jeff is doing that, why would you want a battery simulator if you're an IoT guy?
Because you don't want the impedance of the instrument to affect the outcome.
That's one reason. That's
repeatability.
Right. That's another reason. You know, typically people, when they have a brand new big battery, they can care less what happens. Their processor's going to work, the radios are going to work. But you know, what happens is that battery gets down to 20% or 30% state of charge. That's really, as a designer, where you want to know what happens.
And you don't want to wait a month or two for that to happen.
And you don't want to wait a month. So Jeff is going to show you how you can simulate that with a battery model.
So this is a precision power supply battery simulator. It has three different modes of operation. One of them is this regular power supply. It's 120 watt, 0 to 20 volts, 6 amp power supply. Okay? You can use it as a nice power supply. It also happens to have a 6 amp digital integrated multimeter as well. Well, that kind of comes in as a battery test portion right here. So if you, I'm trying not to shoot your nav off. I kind of put over here this model that it can generate. This is a state of charge. This particular power supply will do a 101 point state of charge model. So you got a 0.0, 1, 2, 3, all the way to 100. Okay, that's the state of charge of the battery, percentage state of charge, 50% state of charge, okay? For each one of these values, you get a voltage, open circuit voltage to the battery, and then you get an equivalent series resistance of the internal portion of the battery. So you have to have these three as an array, and this would generate that array. Then you can take it and port it over to something else. Now, this particular unit here, the 2281, is really good for rechargeable batteries, because what it does is you put a rechargeable battery in there and you charge it up. Then we'll see what that looks like, and it'll be calculated. We'll be making measurements on voltage and current and calculating the equivalent series resistance for the battery. Okay. If you want to do a non-rechargeable battery, then you would get an SMU. Now, an SMU is a little bit different animal, and then it can charge, it can do a model on recharging and discharging. So if you look at this graph I did right here, here's voltage right here, and here's a plus voltage, minus voltage. And here's negative current plus current. Power supplies operate in this range here and this range here, these quadrant one and quadrant three. These other quadrants are for sinking. So think of sinking as you're dissipating power, okay? A variable resistance. Make sense? So I can output a voltage and output a current. I can also use it as a load to discharge a battery with. Think of it as kind of a power supply and a multimeter all in one, but it also has a load as well. And that's what an SMU is. Pat's going to talk about the SMU, but this does have that similar type of capability. So the battery test, we're not going to do that because it would take a while to discharge a battery so we could characterize like a AA battery, hook it up and discharge it and see what that looks like, and then generate this model over here. So we're just going to go and do the battery simulation portion of it. So I don't know if you can see that very well. The colors are kind of, so on the display here, this is supposed to be green, and this is supposed to be blue. This says SOC 100%, and this is in amp hours. Now I picked 0.005 amp hours, so it would be very, very low, and I could discharge the battery very quick with the propeller I'm going to put on there. And then here's the equivalent series resistance. And here's the open circuit voltage, and here's the voltage at the terminals, like with a load, and then you'll see the current draw here. So you'll see a couple of things that'll change. So I'm going to run this. What I have is a battery system for a drone propeller. So you can kind of see the propeller up at the top. I have to be careful I don't hit, it's just kind of sitting there. So I'm going to power this on. But right now, if you notice, I got 100% state of charge. Okay? I'm going to turn it on. It's going to take around 70 seconds. And watch the state of charge drop. The amp hours go down. It's 0.004 now. The equivalent series resistance, as it gets towards the bottom, will go up. And of course, you'll see the current draw will go down. So I'm just going to let this run. You can kind of see what it's doing. Hopefully, you can kind of read those letters.
So, as it was pointed out, this is something that you don't want to wait months to do. You really need it to be repeatable as well. This is something you do.
Any questions on this while it's winding down? So this simulator is simulating a battery to this to my drone loader, and it's draining it out.
I have a question.
Yes.
If you anticipate that you use batteries from several different sources to power your IoT device, you take for granted that they'll have different characteristics over time as they're depleted. Do you have a way of modeling them if you take, say, a batch of them and testing them to determine the ESR and the open circuit voltages?
Absolutely. In fact, let me do something real quick, because one of the things that somebody said, I heard repeatability, but also you want to take forever. So one of the things I'm going to do, you see where it says state of charge right? Where is it? I don't know if you can see that. State of charge right there. I'm going to change that. I'm going to say make the state of charge to 25%. Yeah, you probably can't read it, but I'm going to put 25% right there. So a little while ago, I had 100%, right? I'm going to enter that. So turn it on. So now I'm running it from a 25% condition. So this enables you to test it at different levels and get repeatability and see how it performs as a battery's drain. That's really what you want to know, especially if you've got frequency signals that are changing.
You said it simulates the battery, but it will also characterize batteries?
Yes.
Through measure them and characterize them?
Yes. In fact, let me run this again real quick, and I'll show you something on that. So let me put this back up to 100%. Let me just run it. So I've been showing you the numbers. Let me show you the graph. So this is current. You can't see the colors. But this is voltage as it's going down. And what's going up and down, the RPMs, is the current draw. The current draw is going up and down between these values. You can't quite read these values because numbers are so small.
But there's a couple ways you can model a battery. You can get a model from the manufacturer. They'll give you that, particularly if you're going to buy a couple thousand batteries. Amazing. The other thing you can do is you can model it with an SMU. Right? So you can use an SMU to load a battery, take that data in. We have a script that does that. So basically, you create your own model.
Okay, so this device will not load the battery and do that test.
Not to create the model.
So this guy right here will generate a model for a rechargeable battery. Yeah. It will not generate a model for a non-rechargeable battery. That's where you need the SMU. Because it can generate a model for a rechargeable or non-rechargeable battery. This will only do rechargeable batteries.
Yes. I've often wondered this. How is state of charge determined? What is that a measurement of?
So. This right here, you see that array? So when I say a battery model, this device, this will do it with a TSP script, this will do it internally. It'll generate this model of state of charge is 0 to 100. So that's 50% of the state of charge. And that state of charge is a combination of the voltage, open circuit voltage of the battery, and the internal resistance.
Okay.
Well, I think he's talking about being a real battery.
Right. Yeah. So the battery industry defines state of charge a little differently.
Yeah.
Right.
you know, if you think of it like a gas tank, right? A gas tank, you measure how high a gas tank is by how many gallons of fuel it is.
Right. So they all just the gas tank.
Stage charge is kind of basically when you think about these PMIC devices and power measurement devices, they're really kind of somewhat counting electrons, right? Instead of counting gas going out. So the state of charge to me, it has, you know, half as many electrons as this battery could hold when it was full.
Okay.
That's kind of how it works. And that's also sometimes your phones, they don't do it as much anymore. You're like, you know, the gas gauge on my phone, the battery on my phone, the battery level just doesn't seem to make sense. And you reset the phone and it kind of starts making sense. It's because your battery's wearing and this PMIC needs to be recalibrated or reboot will often do that.
So the textbook definition of state of charge is the battery has a nameplate capacity.
Right.
Amp hours and milliamp hours. And state of charge is 100% of that is a full battery. But the initial new battery. Then his batteries, as he's rechargeable lithium ion lithium polymer, batteries are cycled. You know, you get out 300, 400 cycles, and now there's been a capacity thing. And so the state of charge is different because it was the nameplate state of charge. And now maybe we're at 40% of the nameplate state of charge. Right? Therefore, the problem. So the smart instruments needs to accommodate that.
Yeah, they will take in a variety of different types of battery models. Like this, I just happen to have booted it up and loaded it in the lithium-ion battery. But you can do AA batteries, you can do lead batteries. You can put all the different models in there.
And how? What are those models? Are they like worse? Some sort of? I'm trying to figure out.
Standard for a battery.
Are they based on some sort of statistical analysis of batteries in the industry, or where do they come from?
I do not know that.
Yeah, you know what? I don't know that. I know it's just like, basically they'll give you a spreadsheet and a bunch of equations, right? And so how they, you know, if you go to Duracell, how they get that, I don't know. But they probably get it by doing something like this a couple of zillion times.
Yeah, I've seen them take the CR2032, which is a common button battery, and load it in here and discharge it.
Yeah.
So it puts a load, it discharges it, and it kind of builds this model so that now it can emulate a CR2032, but you don't have to be at 100%. Maybe you want it at 25% capacity and see what your device does at 25% capacity and make that very, very repeatable. Yeah, absolutely.
So one question, does that mean you're simulating the battery over here?
Yes, that's exactly what this is doing right now.
So what's the capacity of the battery you can put it? I mean, there should be some milliamp hours, you should define the battery capacity. So how can you define that? I mean, you know, suppose if I got my mobile phone, it has got around 2000 mAh. So how can we define the capacity of the battery in the simulation?
Well, there are several different things you can put on here. You probably can't see this. Let me see. This tells me the different model types that you can put in here. The next one says dynamic, which means it's static. That means the VOC and the SOC is constant. It's not changing. So it's like running at 100%. But I put in dynamic because I want you to see what it looks like for the battery to drain, right? The next one is VOC and SOC. And the next over here is where you put the full voltage of what the battery is supposed to be, the empty voltage, and then here you can put a current limit right here. And the next one's capacity. So in this particular case, you can't see it, but right here I put in 0.005 milliamp hours. That's where I put that on. Sorry, it's crystal clear over here, but it's not very clear over there. And I got the best camera there was. I think it's a projector. Any questions on that so far?
This is cool. This is a very interesting instrument.
What's that?
This is cool.
Yeah, the thing I want to get clear, because this is a cool product, because it can generate the model on a rechargeable battery, but it kind of has a limit. So it does it based on a rechargeable battery. So you can recharge the battery and get the model of what that'll look like. So then it can do a discharge and charge. this can generate the model on either a discharging a battery or recharging a battery.
What is the current resolution?
Ooh, boy, that's a little
bit. Yeah, so I'll tell you what, I don't know the answer, but on that battery simulator and that SMU, actually, all three of these things, it's really, really good. I mean,
it's like in the new
mean, we're literally almost counting electrons on those boxes there.
Yeah.
So I don't know the spec, but, you know, a lot of industry drivers kind of base their design around these three guys because they're really, really accurate.
Well, there's a, you only need to go so low because batteries self-discharge it.
Yeah, but you know, you do have like some of these larger companies that, you know, there's some of them in Austin too, where they literally want, I mean, they're worried about making a button cell battery last, you know, 25 years instead of 15 years. And when you get to that level.
Wouldn't it self-discharge in that time?
You know what? They don't. I mean, I have a customer that makes these rain. Basically, they detect rain, so they shut off these automatic sprinkler systems. The battery life that they spent is like 25 years on that product.
Failure mechanism of coin cells.
I don't know how they
evaporation
do it, so.
through the polypropylene.
So Jeff, you want me to jump into these other stuff?
Yeah, what I was trying to do real quick,
okay, so when Jeff is setting that up, I want to go over these two instruments right here. It'll be quick, okay? These two aren't linked together. You're looking at two separate boxes. This is a SMU. This is an SMU. Anybody know what an SMU stands for? Source measure unit. So you can think of it as an instrument that can supply voltage and measure current at the same time. It actually works in water, so it can sink and supply. So what are we doing here? I just bought this off a spark plug, and I pushed some simple code into it to scroll these LEDs across here. But this SMU is powering up this microcontroller, and which is running this code in here. And what I have it doing is measuring current, okay, as these LEDs go across. So that's what you're seeing right here. The more LEDs are on, the more current is being pulled out of this. The fewer LEDs, the less current. We can zoom in on that. I'm going to show that in this demo. This guy right here, this is a multimeter, okay? But it's not your father's one. Seven and a half digit, it samples up megasample a second. I have a small Bluetooth device on here, and when I push this button, you're going to hear a beep, okay? And it's basically going to say, hey, I'm going to try to pair with somebody's phone. Nobody's got the app on it, so it's not okay. So I have this thing waiting to trigger on current. I say, you know, I want you to trigger when you see 78 milliamps. So I'm going to push this button, and I trigger this instrument and stopped. So you can see, what we have on the screen here is when it beeped, it drew more current. Okay, so I can zoom in on this. And I can actually throw up cursors on this waveform. I can actually tell you the frequency of that beep because of the reading of the current. Okay. And I did that all in one single shot measurement. It's got a ton of dynamic range because of the A to D. So if you're somebody who is interested in how much current that takes, but at the same time, you're interested in what your current looks like, why this guy is looking for a device, you know, pulsing, just looking for a device, looking for a device, you can do that all in one shot. So in this instance, we're looking at a few milliamps, right? We're zoomed in on that in a scale that's over 100 milliamps. So a ton of dynamic range, right? One shot measure. Great measurement.
What's the sampling bandwidth for this?
Say it again, please.
What's the sampling bandwidth?
1 megasample per second.
1 megasample. For me?
What's the dog?
Cost of the polys. I'll let Jeff talk about
that. I don't have the numbers, as you can well imagine. I sell quite a few products, but they're using these type of polys are just $1,000.
How much?
$2,000. The one I was going to try to show you, but I don't know if this is going to show up very well. I have a fluorothermal imaging camera looking at that board. Is that coming in color?
No. If we hallucinate hard, we need a lot more Lone Star.
The colors.
The fluorothermal imaging camera is a very nice tool for helping you to find hot spots on boards as well as shorts, and been able to see that one spot that got that kind of started growing.
Does it come out?
Yeah, it's a blob now. It's a red blob. You can kind of see if I put my finger right below it. You can kind of see it right there. Yeah, it's not showing very well. It's a little bit like the spectrogram that you saw a little while ago, where if anything gets really hot, it's in your hotter colors, orange, yellows, reds, that sort of thing. And then you put the little reticle on it, and it tells you exactly what the temperature is on that particular part. So I can kind of rotate this, and you can kind of see. So this is a new product that Fluor came out with, where you put your circuit board down here. It's like a microscope, so you adjust up or down, you get it in focus, and you look at what your hot spots, and they'll have all those different, you know, your colder temperatures are typically, here, I'll put my hand in. See my hand right there? See how it's kind of hotter colors? So that's what it's for. It's what law enforcement and military guys have been using for decades to Fluor provide a product so they can find the bad guy. This is the same thing, except for now it's used by the electronics industry to find what your hot spots. Because every component will be a different color based on the temperature. And you can see all the real bright yellows and oranges and reds. And then all your blues are your products are running a lot cooler. So really good for looking at shorts and what's generating the most heat in your design. This is the Fluor came out, this is the first, most of the ones are handheld. This is the first one they've ever come out with. It's kind of this one's $2,500. But it's designed for the electronics industry. Yes.
As I understand it, there's difficulty using it with reflective surfaces. Give kind of a qualitative explanation of how reflective it has to be before you can use it.
I do not know that. Yeah, and that's not where you would use that. If you want to use it, where you can see, you don't want to run through a glass or anything.
Well, I understand. I'm just saying. I'm trying to get a. I have no experience with it. I'm trying to get a feel for what can I use it on. For example, if there's a shiny metal object, will that not show the correct temperature? Or
the shininess, I don't think affects it because it's looking at the infrared portion of the spectrum.
Well, but what if it's reflecting infrared?
That I guess I do not know.
You know, then it would be reflecting the room temperature, maybe. I don't know. That's what I'm asking. I really don't understand that.
A lot of the air conditioning temperature people that are installing and sealing up houses use the handheld units. I had a handheld unit one time and I was looking at all the hot spots on my garage door, all my windows on the outside on a cold winter night. And then it was like 25 degrees. I took my camera because I heard some giggling and I saw a guy and a girl between two cars kissing. Boy, they just lit up like a Christmas tree. It was pretty good. Anyway,
were you through with your portion?
Yeah.
I'm ready for the next slot.
Okay.
I'm good, sir.
Feel free to look at this afterwards if you like. I'll leave it up there if anybody wants to see it.
So, you want to see about the spectrum analyzer? This is true. This is built to build spec. so it can take a lot of those trots.
Okay, so I'm gonna start rolling here pretty quick. So we were talking about EMI. Does anybody know what EMI is?
Electromagnetic interference?
Exactly, yeah. So there's a lot of EMI out there, it's interference, but really instead of it being like RF interference, it's kind of close interference, it radiates. And if you're designing a part or trying to get it out of the market, at some point in time, you're going to have to either rely on somebody telling you that this thing doesn't emit it and it has some specification, or you're going to be worried about it. Somebody's gonna ask you how to do that. So, what's the problem with that? The problem with that is to get that compliance and that certification is expensive. You have to go to, there's a couple places here in Austin that do it and send it off, but it's expensive to go there and get your product tested, put it in the chamber, and then tell you, you know what, it passes compliance. Yes, sir.
When you pay them all that money to get that certification, then do they become liable if in fact that their analysis proved wrong?
I think my sense is what they guarantee you is that the part that you brought them on that day passes their compliance.
Okay.
That's what they tell you. And so what happens when the next one you build? I think that I don't know how they control that.
Well, they don't certify; they just measure.
Yeah. Well, they certify. I think. People do certify that. They'll give that device that you brought in a certification, right?
I don't think that applies to just unless you're talking about an intentional radiator that has to be licensed.
Okay.
But I'm no expert.
I'm not either.
So. My experience has been they just give you the results. Here you go, and it's up to you to say.
The whole idea behind this is to get to where you get there, and you spend that bukus of money to do the test that is going to be pretty certain it's going to pass. That's what this is for. Because that could be a lot of money.
So, So your board, is putting out a bunch of unwanted emissions, right? And so how do you take a look at that? So I'm gonna kind of skip the slides and I'm gonna go with this arrow, please. I'm gonna go straight to it here. Because the message is when you take a part to a compliance lab and you're gonna give them money to give you the sticker or tell you what the results are, they're gonna charge you a lot of money for it. So what you wanna do as a designer, is when you give it to them, you want to make sure that you have the best shot of them giving you an okay. So this, Jeff has been, the signals he's been showing you have been coming off this demo board, and one thing that we learned about this demo board is it radiates like crazy. This port is basically a transmitter. So I have this near field probe, okay, and I have it hooked up to the spectrum analyzer of this oscilloscope, and we're tuned at a center frequency of 150 meg. So this is made by a company called Beehive. You get these from Test Equity as well.
Not much.
And they're really handy because you put these on your spectrum analyzer, and watch what happens when I touch down on this board. See all that noise? So, as we talked about spectrum analyzers a little bit ago, this is the frequency on the x-axis, power or amplitude is on the y-axis. That board is pushing out a lot of power at a lot of different frequencies around that. It turns out there's an FDG out here that just streams. Screams at 150 megahertz when you're running. But this is the type of thing that if you knew some information about compliance, that at some distance your emissions had to be under a certain level, this is the kind of instrument that can really help you get a good feeling on what your performance is going to be like when you go to compliance. If that's what you decide to do, if I'm going to go to compliance, I'm going to send a module to somebody else that won't worry about compliance.
So do you know who the people are at the other end of this who enforce and check and verify?
You know, I don't. But I know somebody does.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's expensive. You know, I happen to kind of run into one of these Raspberry Pi guys. It's the man who works for Raspberry Pi organization. It was right when the Raspberry Pi Zero came out.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a $5 controller. And I asked him, I said, hey, you know what? We guys can put Wi-Fi on board on this thing. And what he told me is we're not going to do that because when we put it on the normal size Raspberry Pi, to get that compliance for manufacturing was about $200,000.
Wow.
And so he told me, he said, so because on a Raspberry Pi Zero, it just doesn't make sense. Well, about 8 months later, they came out with Raspberry Pi Zero. So obviously, either he didn't know or he didn't want me to know, right? But it's expensive. And I don't know enough about how you get these stickers and how that works, mm-hmm. other than it's expensive to get them. It's something you kind of have to have them if you're going to sell a product.
At the end of the day, it's the FCC, the regulator.
Well, those the really expensive, that's for intentional radiators, where you have to validate that you meet certain emissions requirements, and then also usually there's also an industry certification. So Bluetooth has theirs, Wi-Fi has theirs, and that's where it really gets, because now you're getting into protocols. You have to prove that you meet the certain protocols and all that stuff. So that 200,000 number, and it's also international.
Yeah, I mean, I just thought it was interesting. Yeah, they also have like emissions testing, like when you put something into the wall, what kind of emissions go into the wall? Right? So there's all kind of
right conducted emissions, but for an unintentional radiator, the testing numbers aren't anywhere near that high. They're more along the lines of $10,000.
Yeah, I'm a ham radio operator. The fines are stiff: $10,000 or 10 years imprisonment. Potentially transmitting signals you should be transmitting.
Wow. Yeah, I often wondered if I ever made a device and started selling it, who I would hear from first.
Yeah. Like if you make a radar jammer,
what's really scary is if you're intentionally jamming, enough people complain and the FCC catch you, they can catch you in a microsecond from you keying up something just very quick. They spot you and know exactly where you're at, and they can hone in on you and toast at that point. It's pretty scary.
That's why I have a real fast band.
So this is kind of wireless certification. It was asked this RSA 306 that I keep dropping. There's a bunch of different certification protocols built into it. At the same time, probably over a dozen, two dozen. So if you do need to get some certification, there are software packages that you can apply to single PC, and it will give you those. It'll test those certification specs. And this is about deployment. Just remember, you know, IoT device, you're not alone. You got a lot of people chattering out there. You probably have a couple people that are doing some experiments. Everything we showed you is hopefully kind of helps get you not only around this, but also thinking about power consumption, how would I measure that, how do I make sure the radios turn on and off, how do I latch onto a bus to see what is happening into my radios as bus signals are going across. So, you know, that's kind of what we tried to kind of point out through the whole process. And really, that's, that kind of is all that I have. Jeff and I have questions. If you have any questions, we're here to answer them.
For a screwdriver, I did have, if you got some questions, anybody can tell me what SMU stands for?
Yeah, you're a teller.
What's that? Say it again?
Supply using.
Close enough.
That's close enough. I give you credit.
Source measurement. It's two screwdrivers and one battery. Mm-hmm. You got a question?
Do you have any insight into or experience with production testing?
Yeah, actually quite a bit, depending on what's the next question.
Well, one of the things that I've been pondering is you're in a production environment. How do you prevent one unit from interfering with the test of another unit?
Yeah,
what are some of the techniques?
That's a great question. They screen it. They maybe test. They test on wafer where they only power up one at a time. That's not very common, but they screen it. They screen it. And they, in the end, like I think when people are doing terminal radios, that thing is going through a screening room, getting turned on and tested.
So you're saying the test station, I'm testing a cell phone, I've got a little miniature screen room that I close, like
or,
a Faraday cage.
Or you may have,
that I enclose
you may have. You may have 1,000 miniature Faraday cages.
Well, I know, that's the point, is there are multiple stations, and so how do you keep one? And
there are companies that make those.
Yeah.
You tell them what kind of connectors you want on your device you're testing, they'll build it for your customers. I've seen other, I've got customers in town that take the entire system they're trying to test and roll it into the screen room. Leave all the electronic stuff, PC and all that stuff, they leave it out because it makes a bunch of noise.
I got a question. What is the x-axis on the spectrogram?
Frequency.
Who said
that? Give that answer.
Who said that? I got one. What does MDO stand for?
I don't think we talked about that.
Actually, I did. All right, how about what kind of batteries can this?
Lithium ion?
Who said they're rechargeable? And to your question, it can do any kind of battery. You tell it what kind of model or you can characterize a battery.
I got a question. You're going to buy anything to make measurements on this? What company are you going to buy it from?
Who said that?
Well, no, I literally love them, so I'm going to answer anything.
All right.
Jeff, I was curious.
Yeah.
Have you guys started to see a lot of people on the testing side working with low power wide area networks and the LPWA, Flora, Sigfox?
My territory is kind of Central Texas. So if it's not here in Central Texas, I have Southern New Mexico, South Texas, West Texas, and Central Texas. I don't have Dallas, I don't have Houston. You have Silicon Valley. Everybody kind of molds to their type of customer that they have. I'm molding to, you know, here in town, the AMDs, the HPs, the Intels, the Silicon, Cirrus, National Instruments, all those are all my customers. So if there's none of those in town, yes.
In West Texas and New Mexico, are y'all doing anything in oil and gas?
I have some people that bought some things oil and gas, but typically oil and gas people are just using, you know, basic maintenance gear. Mm-hmm.
So this is a good y'all question. So these test devices, is it a match for these devices? And this has become an IoT device, and they're storing this data on the cloud. So this is a real-time data. This data that they're capturing, how are you guys pushing to a cloud so that it can be analyzed later?
I don't see it happening, especially with products like this. The data rate of this guy alone, because if you know anything about RF data, typically to really fully characterize and capture all the information, you need to really go back and evaluate it after the fact. It's 300 megabits, 9Q data, it's extremely fast. So if you notice, he's running a USB 3.0 port. Not only do you have to have USB 3.0 hardware, but you have to have USB 3.0 software drivers and a solid state drive to keep up with the data rate coming in this computer. Good example, one of the demos I love to tell was one of my surveillance type customers. the demo I did for him was I took the 88 to 108 FM band, and I saw one signal, which is a radio station, is really strong. I put the marker on there, and I decoded it. Turns out it was back when Obama was president at the time. I recorded his voice for 30 seconds. By the time, and I was able to go back and play it to my customer. You could see all the waveforms live, even though it was captured the night before. It was all live and everything. But the data size was over a gig for the 30 seconds or so that I captured that signal. So it's huge. So going to the cloud, I think there's huge limitations with, for something like this anyway.
Jim mentioned that like most of the RF analysis is bursting, right? And so that's typically what you do. You would need a disk the size of Montana to store 20, 30 seconds of data. It gets heavy. Now, I do have customers who capture a lot of data, right? And they have big disks to do it. But even when they do that, they may sequence these things so they capture, because you just can't stream that much data. And then they together. And these are government research agencies that have an unlimited budget called us that doesn't do that type of thing. Most people, commercial people, do not do that.
Yeah. Okay. Those are the guys with three-letter acronyms.
Yeah.
Agencies.
Okay.
Any other questions? I've been really easy group.
So if anybody wants to come up here and play with any of these instruments, you can't break them, to my knowledge. You can buy it.
I do have a stack of catalogs and business cards in case you're interested. I'll leave these up here. This is only handy as a test equipment, but it's got my card. I think most of our stuff on there. I got my business cards up here. And I'm local, so feel free to reach out to me anytime.
Thanks for your patience and thanks for sticking. You got any closing comments?
Nope.